Hello friends, welcome to a new topic today. In this chapter, we are going to learn about pediatrics, and in the pediatrics, we are going to learn about the pelvic fractures which are associated with pelvic fractures. So if you see, these pelvic fractures are actually high velocity trauma. Okay, what are the mechanism of action of pelvic fractures? Mechanism of action of pelvic fractures include, there should be high speed road traffic accident or fall from height. Okay, if this fall from height is present, for this fall from height is most commonly associated with sacrum fracture. Okay, this sacrum fracture is also called as, there is a name given for it, that is called as jumper's fracture. It is something like that. The fracture line runs in the sacrum. Okay, that is jumper's fracture in the sacral fractures. Okay, now let us learn the first classification of pelvic fractures. All the pelvic fractures can be classified into two major types. One, we have the stable pelvic fracture, right? Second, we have the unstable pelvic fracture. So what do you see in stable pelvic fracture? In stable pelvic fracture, as the name says, the pelvic ring is intact. So here the pelvic ring is intact in stable pelvic fracture. You will see that the pelvic ring is intact. Whereas in unstable pelvic fracture, the pelvic ring is disrupted. Okay, how is pelvic ring disrupted? This is the whole pelvic ring. This is intact. But here, see, there will be some problem in the pelvic ring, discontinuation of pelvic ring. So this unstable fracture is again divided into three types based on the mechanism of fracture. Okay, it is divided into three types, this unstable fracture. So if you see, one, we have anteroposterior compression injury. In the unstable fracture, we have, number one, anteroposterior compression injury. We also have side-to-side compression injury. And we have rotational compression injury. Okay, in anteroposterior compression injury, there is compression from the anterior and posterior end. Okay, because see, like this, the person, there is compression in anterior and posterior end. As a result, there is pubic diastasis. This pubic bone becomes, it opens, and as a result we have widening or open book injury. This anteroposterior compression injury is called as, there is a name given to this, this is called as widening of book or pubic diastasis. Okay, then we have lateral compression injury. So what is this lateral compression injury mean? Lateral compression injury is compression from the lateral side, from the sideways. And this lateral compression injury, it is, here we see the lateral compression injury, which we see here is sacroiliac joint with pubic rami. This is the sacroiliac joint fracture is present, along with pubic rami fracture is present. And this fracture is called as Malgagny fracture. What is this Malgagny fracture? Malgagny fracture is rami fracture plus sacroiliac joint fracture. So here this you can say has bucket handle fracture also. So that is lateral, sideward, side to side compression injury. Right, next, what about the rotational injury? So in rotational injury, rotational compression injury, the force is, if this is the person, the force is rotational force which results in this injury. Okay, in this rotational compression injury, here if you see, there will be bilateral superior and inferior pubic rami fracture, and that is called as straddle fracture. See, these are the superior rami fracture. This is superior rami fracture bilateral, and this is the inferior rami. So there is inferior rami fracture bilateral, and this is called as straddle fracture. Right, next. Right, how are you going to treat this case? Treatment is based on the stability. See, if the patient is stable, then you can do conservative management. If the patient is unstable, then obviously you will have to do a fixative procedure as soon as possible. Okay, see, in this pelvic fracture, if you see, it is one thing is very important, that emergency treatment is very important, because in pelvic fracture there is increased chances of patient landing up into blood loss, and because of this, blood loss will be almost 1.5 to 2 liters or 40% of blood loss can be associated with these pelvic fractures, and thus you should treat it, and it is an emergency treatment. Okay, then how are you going to manage it? What are the steps of management? In the steps of management, first step is, you will have to stop the bleeding. Okay, First, stop the bleeding. How are you going to stop the bleeding? This is done by pelvic binder applicator. You will have to apply a pelvic binder and stop bleeding. Okay, then IV fluids should be given. In the IV fluids, Ringer lactate is the preferred IV fluid. Why Ringer lactate is preferred? Because in the Ringer lactate, this lactate here, it gets converted into pyruvate. This lactate in Ringer lactate gets converted into pyruvate and it forms bicarbonate ion. This bicarbonate ion will inhibit acidosis and thus Ringer lactate is preferred. And one more thing is normal saline. If you see, this normal saline is contraindicated in acidosis. So you don't use this normal saline often. Okay, normal saline is contraindicated in acidosis. So Ringer lactate is the fluid which is actually preferred. Okay, this is one thing which you have to remember. Next, in order to apply a tamponade effect or in order to make everything normal, you will have to apply an external fixator. So external fixator should be applied for tamponade effect. Okay, so these are the things that you have to do whenever a patient from pelvic fracture comes to you. Okay, you will have to maintain the, first you will see whether there is hemodynamic stability or not. If the hemodynamic stability is not proper, then you will have to stop bleeding, give IV fluids, and then give IV fluids. Most commonly Ringer lactate is preferred and external fixator is applied. Then let us learn few points about the polytrauma. When do you call something as polytrauma? Polytrauma is most common with pelvic fractures. Okay, what do you see, when do you call polytrauma? When more than two organ systems are involved, then you call it as polytrauma. Okay, so in polytrauma, most commonly you see hypotension. That is, BP can be 70 by 50 or even less also. Okay, then what should you do? See, if a person collapses, think that a person has collapsed suddenly. Then what should you do? First, you will have to check the carotid pulse and breathing for 10 seconds. So if you check the carotid pulse and if you are able to feel the carotid pulse and the breathing is negative, then it is a case of respiratory depression. So because it is respiratory depression, obviously you should give oxygen support. And if both breathing and pulse, both these are absent, then obviously it is the case of cardiac arrest. Then if breathing is present and pulse, both these are present, then it is, you will have to give ATLS for life-threatening illness. Okay, so this is one thing which you have to remember. So among this is important. If pulse and BP both are positive, if pulse is positive and breathing is negative, then respiratory depression. If pulse and BP both are negative, it is cardiac arrest. So you will have to go to BLS is basic life support and ACLS is advanced cardiac life support should be done. If pulse is present and breathing is present, both these are present, then you will have to think that it is something related to trauma and you will have to do trauma care you should give. Okay, so this is about polytrauma. Then let us learn a few points about hip dislocation. So if you see, among all the fractures which are present, hip dislocation is the most stable fracture which you see. Okay, what is the strongest ligament in hip dislocation? Sorry, in hip joint, if you see, the strongest ligament which you see in hip joint is iliofemoral ligament, is the strongest ligament that you see in hip joint. This hip dislocation is a high velocity injury. Okay, then in this hip dislocation, first you will have to see the what are the different types of hip dislocation. Hip dislocation can be divided into three types. One, we have anterior dislocation, central dislocation, and posterior dislocation. Okay, in anterior dislocation we have flexion, abduction, and external rotation. So in anterior dislocation we have mainly flexion, abduction, and external rotation associated with anterior dislocation. Right, so the patient, that is given by Fabder relation, the mnemonic Fabder. So in this, the hip becomes lower than the joint in the femoral region and you will see limb lengthening is seen. you are seeing limb lengthening in this situation. And hip is lower than the joint in the femoral region. The second is central dislocation. So what are you going to see in this central dislocation? In central dislocation, one is head is palpable. In per rectal examination, if you do a per rectal examination, head is palpable. Here you will see limb shortening. Okay, here the what is central dislocation mean? Central dislocation is if this is the acetabulum. Okay, now the head of the femur will go towards the acetabulum, and as a result, because it goes into the acetabulum, there will be shortening, right? Apparent shortening. The head breaks the acetabulum and goes into fracture dislocation. It's similar. This is the picture. If you see this, it can go like this into the acetabulum. Okay, this is central dislocation. So as a result, there will be shortening, and also the head. Okay, there won't be any fabre or fader, that is flexion, abduction, external rotation, or flexion, adduction, external rotation. There won't be such deformities associated with it. Okay, then the next type of hip dislocation is posterior hip dislocation. What do you see in posterior hip dislocation? In this we see flexion, adduction, and internal rotation. See this here, there is flexion, adduction, and internal rotation. There is flexion, adduction, and internal rotation. Here if you see, there is flexion, okay, abduction, and there is external rotation, right? So these are the injuries which you see here in this posterior hip dislocation. If you see, the hip or femoral head is at the joint level in the femoral area. So because of that, here you see limb shortening is associated with it. Okay, in this posterior dislocation, there is a sign which is called as vascular sign of Neurath. Okay, what is this vascular sign of Neurath? That is, if the femoral artery pulsation is felt, then it is negative vascular sign of Neurath. If femoral artery pulsations are absent, then we can call it as positive vascular sign of Neurath. So this will indicate that there is some injury to the femoral artery. Okay, so this is vascular sign of Neurath, which you see in posterior dislocation. Okay, next, how are you going to treat this posterior dislocation? The treatment of posterior dislocation is, here you can do closed reduction can be planned, and if closed reduction is not feasible, then you can do open reduction. Okay, what are the things that you do in closed reduction? In closed reduction, you can use either Alice method, Stimson's method, Baltimore method. In closed reduction, we can use Alice method, Simpson method, and Baltimore method. In open reduction, if this closed reduction cannot be done, then we have to do an open reduction. This open reduction should always be done within this 6 hours, and this 6 hours is called as golden time. If we do not do this closed reduction in 6 hours, then this can lead to something called as a bigger complication, which is avascular necrosis of head of femur. So this 6 hours is the important and golden time for this thing. Okay, then if this, what is the complication of this open reduction? The complication of this open reduction is this can lead into sciatic nerve palsy also. Okay, so this is about dislocation of hip. So we have learned about the pelvic fractures and hip dislocation. Thank you guys for watching my lecture. In the next class, we will learn about the neck of the femur fracture. Thank you.